Officer Tim Clark, thank you so much for joining CNBC. I want to kick off by just asking you to walk us through the latest numbers from Emirates. Where are we today?
Well, we're bouncing back with a high degree of, dare I say, robustness. We've got all our 777s flying. We've got 40 of our 380s flying. Demand is coming back at such a pace that we're frankly having difficulty trying to supply the assets because we're short of pilots, we're short of cabin crew, we're short of just about everything. But there's no shortage of demand, and it's a really good story. The bottom line is now positive. We're cash positive. We're seeing the beginning of the end.
When do you see a return to profitability?
Hopefully. Well, we're actually making profits now, would you believe? Even with 80 aircraft sitting on the ground, we're making good money. Cargo is very strong. Passenger demand is strong. Fares are giving us a very good yield. If we can maintain this and we can get the fleet flying and the network restored by the summer of next year, we'll be very happy with that.
You're mentioning that you're short of everything in terms of the staffing at this point. Obviously, Emirates had to let a lot of people go during the pandemic. You're bringing people back, as many as 6,000 jobs. Will be there some preference for people who had worked for Emirates before? How are you going through those?
Well, obviously, we're going after people who we laid off. It's not something we were used to doing. We've been an expansionist entity, as everybody knows, for the last 35 years. So we had to let people go. A lot of people are ready to come back. And so we're trying to re-recruit those, if you like. Similarly with the pilots, perhaps more importantly, because they are a precious commodity. We have to bring them back, retrain them, get them onto the 380s where we're short. 777s we have no problem with because we've kept that complement in place. It was the 380s that took the big hit in letting people go. So we're trying, but even that's difficult.
In terms of those 80 aircraft on the ground, how quickly will we see them once again in the sky?
I think we'll have them flying by the summer of next year, July. Again, contingent upon our ability to get the pilots to fly them.
Yeah. You mentioned, of course, we talked about the jobs, but you mentioned the idea of shortages of everything. Obviously, the world is dealing right now with a global supply chain disaster, if you will. How quickly do you think, from a transportation perspective, that's going to resolve itself?
You know, it's a very difficult question to answer. You talk about supply chain disruption. You talk about a gross distortion in the labor markets. In all spheres of that. And so when do you see equilibrium coming back as a result of all the strange things that have gone on, particularly in the labor market? I can see that by the end of next year, when you start seeing the spike in inflation starting to moderate and equilibrium returning probably at the last quarter calendar of 22 and into the first half of 23. I think then you'll get some sort of, let's say the heat will come out of the situation, I hope anyway.
You mentioned inflation, rising prices. Right now, oil's over $80 a barrel. That, of course, a big story for folks out here in the region. But for you as an airline, what does that mean for your bottom line?
Well, of course, $80 is, we've been there before. We've been much higher than that before. At the moment, our fare levels, our yields per seat kilometer, our cargo rates per ton kilometer are high, and we're able to manage all of that. Now, if we get a fall off in fuel price, or we got a reduction in the income unit revenues, then things will change. But at the moment, we're managing it. It's anybody's guess is what's going to happen. I think we've got about 15 months of turbulence, but we'll be all right.
Nobody likes turbulence. When you think about the industry as a whole, where do you see the blind spots in the
where
recovery?
Do I see?
The blind spots in the recovery.
Again, I think to my point I was saying, mentioning about the labor markets, causing all sorts of issues for the airline community. Also, the airline community has taken large amounts of debt onto their balance sheets, and their main problem now is eliminating that debt off their balance sheet to get the gearing right so that they can then re-enter the purchase of these highly expensive aircraft, which they need for sustainable reasons and all the other bits and pieces. So that's probably going to be something very difficult for them to manage over the course of the next 3-5 years. But eventually they'll get there.
In terms of that changing identity and the way that airlines have had to adapt, you've also got a changing nature of passengers, particularly in the United States and Europe. You're seeing a lot of passenger disruption, frankly, on aircraft. Staff's learning to deal with that as postings to social media go viral. How do you, as president of Emirates, encourage your staff to deal with situations like that? Because there's a lot of discomfort, I think, with people flying still post-pandemic.
Yeah, I to the specific pandemic issues with regard to cleanliness, hygiene, protection, et cetera, et cetera. We introduced that way back in the summer of 2020. We had the crew gowned up, we had the aircraft being sterilized, it was better than an operating theater in a hospital, dare I say. And we've maintained that level. So when people get on our aeroplanes, they know that everything that can be done has been done to sanitize the environment that they're going to be traveling in. And all the time we're still insisting that people wear masks, we're handing out sanitizers, everything that, and the toilets are maintained in a very, very healthy, sanitized condition all the time. So when somebody uses the toilets, a crew go in and clean it out. They're already, you've got all the PPE in place to do that. It's laborious, but at least it gives the passengers comfort that they know they're going on, particularly on the aircraft that we fly long haul. If you're going from here to New York, it's 40 to 15 hours. They want to know that all the time there is going to be some concentration and focus on the sanitization, the health of the aircraft cabin, and we excel in that.
Do you see those measures being rolled back anytime soon, or are we talking another 2 years or so?
I think probably, you know, we've got another wave coming in from Europe at the moment, what they call the fourth wave. So long as this pandemic continues to morph into various waves or pockets, there's always going to be a high concern about what people do. That's no bad thing, actually. Washing hands regularly is something we should have already been doing anyway. But I think not just in the airline community, whether it be all the transport modes, shipping, rail, whatever, road, there's going to be a sustained focus on how you go about keeping yourself protected. And very much in the eyes of the individual, but corporations, entities like Emirates will always keep that high focus. We really don't want to feel that people are going to be worried about they're going to get something, even though we have these superb filters on board which take out everything but 0.2% of all the germs, and the air's changed every 2 minutes completely. We've got to keep that very much in the center of our product offering, particularly in flight and on the ground.
It's interesting. This is, I think, maybe my fourth or fifth air show. I know that you've done several of these yourself. You've been in the Gulf for almost 50 years. Air shows tend to be either about the big orders that Emirates is making, whether it be A380s or something from Boeing, or a few times I've been to this air show, it's been very military focused. This time around, we're talking a lot more about freight. How does that impact your bottom line?
Well, freight has been our lifesaver, quite honestly. And I won't go into the reasons why. I think we all know that. And as maritime shipping rates went from $2,000 a container to $12,000, $14,000 a container, so there was a shift. And to the point about supply chain restrictions, the just-in-time inventory business models still required that to take place, so they obviously went to air. And as a result of that, we have about 20 of our 777s, which are passenger aircraft, which are operating as freighters. We could do more, actually. Our cargo people want the whole lot. So I can see that going on for another couple of years.
Yeah, do you consider adding to that list of freight?
Well, sorry.
Would you consider adding numbers?
Oh, yes, we will. But we're trying to get more freighters, yes. 777 freighters. We're just about embark on a conversion of a lot of our old ERs into freighters. This is something that we're looking at with slightly different eyes than we used to in the old days. It really looks as though this is here to stay.
Yeah. When you think about this as a bigger picture, LL landing flights in Dubai, something that a few years ago no one would have thought was possible. When you take a step back and think about where Dubai is headed, so many people expected to come in for the expo. What do the numbers look like to you in terms of visitors?
Well, goodness me, I'm told that we've gone past 4 million people in expo already. Some of my colleagues were down there yesterday and the day before saying that the mix, the nationality mix, is quite extraordinary. So it's doing exactly what the planners and the organizers of Expo wanted. They wanted it to be a truly international exposition, and it's shaping up to be that way. And I can see going forward over the next 4 or 5 months that that's going to grow. What you tend to find with these expos, that in the first 3 or 4 months it's fairly subdued, and then it really accelerates during the last three. Well, what we're seeing here is already an acceleration of footfall in the expo. So it's clearly a very, very well planned, organized, and the content in the show is particularly interesting, I'm told, because there are 198 pavilions, all of which have really pushed the boat out with trying to get the content interested to the people coming in.
Yeah, you don't see a second wave in Europe in terms of COVID impacting visitors.
I see a fourth wave coming through, we have all sorts of concerns about what may happen. Holland has already locked itself down. The Prime Minister of the United Kingdom was saying we've got to be very careful, get the boosters for people over 50 to ensure that we don't find ourselves in a situation where we have to go into the same kind of restrictions again. Look, it's anybody's guess as to what's going to happen.
And what does that mean for Emirates in terms of...
Well, we've got to look at it very carefully, because if the European markets, which have already started to open in a big way, start to go the other way, then we've got to have to deal with that. But, you know, we will deal with it. And we're good at doing that. We're very good at working around problems. And we'll just do what we have to do.
Tim, it's wonderful having you on CNBC. Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.